thank you, Ben, for making yourself available for this conversation.
Thank you for having me.
I'm doing a history of the School of Engineering, and talking to graduates give me an opportunity to try to locate myself back in a period of time that I wasn't there and you were. So I'm trying to extract as much of that period from you as I can. But I'm also interested in you as a both as a product of the school, but as someone who chose to come to this school. 1982, you show up in the master's program, is that right?
1981. Yeah.
And where had you been before coming to the school?
I went to University of Lagos for a postgraduate diploma in metallurgy. And before that, to the University of Nigeria at Nsukka for a degree in bachelor's degree in mechanical engineering.
Okay, so two engineering degrees, both from African universities.
Yes.
And directly from Lagos to New York?
To New York, yeah. Okay. I came January 18, it was 6 inches of snow on the ground.
A new experience.
I always remember that.
and why, with there being 300 or 400 engineering schools in the U.S., to say nothing of European institutions, why Columbia?
In fact, to start with, I applied to schools outside of even the U.S.
Right.
I got admitted to Oxford, and also I got admitted to Columbia. And one of the things that I was considering was, where is it that I can go, I'll have the greatest potential to develop my mind. I talked to some of my professors in University of Nigeria, and they told me, because some of them graduated in the UK or in England, and some graduated in the US.
Right.
The ones who graduated in England told me that the PhD could be pretty quick, since I wanted to go all the way to the PhD, to the doctorate. It could be pretty quick, it's all set, you know, you go in there and you start writing your thesis, basically. The one who trained in the U.S. told me that the U.S. is pretty rigorous for a doctorate, because you have to do a lot of coursework, up to maybe 60 credits or so of coursework. Mm-hmm. And after that, you have to take an exam, basically. And if you don't pass, then you can continue. So it's really, Americans have the best doctorate. So I had to choose, do I go with the easy one or do I go
right.
So I really wanted a place where I would develop my mind. And so I chose the U.S. because I felt that that would take me to the, I chose Columbia because that would take me to the forefront of knowledge.
Okay.
Deep knowledge.
Without making a judgment that you're going, because your career since Columbia has been here in the United States.
Yes.
That was not the primary consideration. You were taking the tough road, or the more demanding.
I felt more demanding, and you gain a whole lot more
by
coming to Columbia.
All right.
So,
when you got here, any differences between what you expected to find based on your Lagos contacts and the reality, aside from the 6 inches of snow?
Yeah. Okay. When I got here, I found the professors were pretty. They were trying to give you everything you needed to know to be successful. That's what I found.
Okay.
In Nigeria, it was very tough to find the books I needed or the materials I needed. It was like a struggle. When I mean a struggle, I mean a real struggle. Mm-hmm. And here, boy, you know, the library was stocked with books. But I had a problem with the accent. I got used to the English accent, English way of speaking. So, and Americans have a little draw on how they pronounce the word, so I really struggled with that. And so I said to myself, I need to work twice as hard. Because I found that in the class, I had to go back after the class to really try to understand what the professor said. So I had to not just read the textbook, I had to read other books to get counter opinion on it. So I think to me that was the tough part. But because of all the support and the lots of information available everywhere, I found it frankly easier than in Nigeria.
Okay.
When you struggle with finding what you need.
Those non-intellectual struggles that are part of just getting the work underway. Yeah. Who were the people you were taught by or worked with?
I remember Martin Klein.
Mm-hmm.
He was a very professor of operations research. He was instrumental to my really picking up interest in that area. I remember Professor Melman.
Mm-hmm.
He was a professor of industrial engineering, very world-renowned. And he was instrumental to my picking interest in productivity. He was like an expert. In fact, that's where I ended up doing my doctorate. My thesis was in productivity.
And so Seymour Melman was one of the people on your committee, or was he your principal?
He was my main, he was my principal advisor.
Okay.
And then on my committee, I had Professor Klein, I had Professor Golfer, who
right.
is now the dean,
mm-hmm.
Acting dean. So all these people were really instrumental. And then I always remember Professor Damon.
Okay.
I think he's passed, if
he
I remember,
it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So he was great on stochastic processes for operations research. Those were really great professors, great minds.
Small department, but you had three or four people in it who were connected with you.
Yes, very, and they were so helpful. I mean, when I got here, to tell you how good Columbia was to me, I only had enough resources for my master's for 1 year. I didn't know how I was going to do. I know I wanted to go all the way to the doctorate. And I also remember what my brother-in-law told me when I was about coming. I said to him, I'm kind of worried. I'm coming to the U.S. I want to do a PhD. But I don't have enough money for that. And he said to me, well, if you go to any of a school like Columbia and you really show that, you know the material and you do very well, there's always some help. Either you're a teaching assistant or something. So if you do so well, you'll be given an academic scholarship.
Okay.
So that was my biggest worry coming. And I remember when I approached Professor Klein, who was the head of department then, and he said to me, Ben, you know, I'm not sure. This is really very competitive. You have students from all over the world. And we only have two scholarship slots for the doctorate. So why don't you give your name to Barbara Congol, who was the secretary, the admin head then. And then we're going to take all the results and see how people, did well, and then whoever the top two then gets it. So 2 weeks later, I was really so pleasantly, amazingly, and delightfully surprised that Barbara said, oh, Ben, you are one of the two, so.
So then the finances are not
yes.
an issue. And,
yes.
And did it involve, did your fellowship involve some teaching?
It's mostly assisting a professor. Assisted Professor Melman, assisted Professor Norden
mm-hmm.
at some point. So
okay.
those are the two I assisted over the years.
So it was not a very, the demands on your time for the fellowship weren't particularly difficult.
No, they weren't.
Okay.
It was grading papers. I show up in class, obviously,
right.
With the students, and then grading papers and helping with some of the homework stuff.
Okay. And what about your relations with other graduate students in the department? Was it a kind of everybody for himself, or was there some kind of community within the school or within IEOR?
I think within IEOR there was some kind of community. My disappointment will be after I graduated. Because after I graduated for years, you know, never heard from Columbia. So that surprised me. But I think that changed dramatically over the past, I would probably say 6 years,
yeah,
or 7 or 8 years. You know, it's changed for the better.
But as an alumnus, you just didn't, they made no, you could tell.
I could tell. And for me, it was a little disappointing from the engineering school because I met my wife here. I took a class with Professor, but he's in the business school.
Right.
And he taught productivity in the manufacturing setting. So, and that's where I met, who I ended up marrying my wife, right?
Okay.
And after we graduated, the MBA school constantly communicated with her over the years,
yeah,
you know. And each time she gets this mail from Colombia and I don't get anything.
Yeah, I know.
So you can imagine my frustration. So
yeah.
But when I started getting something from the engineer, I was like, yeah, you know, they're, you
but
know,
it's
they're
but a half dozen years ago they found your address.
Yeah, okay, it could be that.
Okay, yeah.
But
but
while I was here though, we had a group of we got really close, you know, we did a lot. I remember one Vincent Omachono. I remember Chong Chow.
Mm-hmm.
I remember Moses, I've forgotten his last name. There are a couple of guys who we hang out with, had social events and stuff like that. And I remember that when I went to do some internship work in the city, I worked in JCPenney for a while. Some of them ended up coming to the company just because of the relationship we built over the years. Yeah. So, but after graduation, I think the Columbia thing just died, you know. But now it's all reawakened again.
Right. But the Columbia credential was of use to you in starting your career.
Excellent.
Okay.
Exceptional. Except in fact, my first job was I saw it on the board here. On the industrial engineering, and looking for an internship position in JCPenney, and it was a former PhD from IEOR,
mm-hmm,
who posted that.
And this
job.
Was at JCPenney?
Yes,
yeah.
JCPenney, because industrial engineering is very broad. You can
yeah.
work in logistics in many industries. So I went and talked with him, and he gave me the job, so that was how my break came. And then after that, my second job, I got a call from someone from AT&T Bell Labs, who also did his PhD in operations research here. And I knew him when he was here. And we were friends. He said to me, I heard that JCPenney is relocating to Texas. The headquarters was on Avenue of Americas then, and they moved to the old, you know, so. Why, you know, my manager would like to talk to you. Why don't you come talk to him in the lab? I said, well, I'm not sure. These guys are pushing on me to move to Texas. All sorts of incentives trying to pull me over there. But I could come and talk. So I went and talked, and I liked what I heard.
Mm-hmm.
JCPenney was very good company, but it looks like AT&T Bell Labs would give me an opportunity to even grow my mind more, learn a whole lot more, and grow. So that drove my
Which
decision.
One of the labs were you? There are two or three, aren't there?
There are many. There are really many. I started with the one in Middletown, New
okay.
Jersey, and I ended up in the one in Morrow Hill.
Okay.
Morrow Hill. And that was where I was for a while. And then, again, my Columbia education played a role in my following job because I ended up going to GE Capital.
Okay.
And that was also a former Columbia alum who I had worked with before in JCPenney who called on me and said, look, I need someone strong to come and run this department. So.
Well, It sounds as if, even though the alumni office may have lost your address, the networking worked pretty well.
Yes.
Several.
Yes, but that was on a personal.
Yeah.
I would say it did. I would say it did because, yeah, all the my the first job, the second and the third were all network related from here.
And then by that time, it's based on other other factors.
Yes.
So those first couple of legs up were were important to you.
Yes, I think after the first really. Even though the networking here helped the second and the third, but I think the foundation was the first.
Okay.
Yeah.
Are you in a position in your career now to hire people?
Yes, I am, and I've come here over the years to look for people here. Colombia has very very good talent, no question about that. It's a solid school.
So this is one of the places you would be,
looking
for.
No question about that.
Yeah.
No question about that.
Well, when you were here, you'd come with a commitment to proceed to a PhD, but it was going to take some time.
Yeah.
Anything more about what you didn't find here that you thought? I mean, mostly I'm collecting good stories, but it helps me, I think, to have some sense of where the school at that point might not have delivered in terms of what you needed or what the expectations were of someone in your, you know, as a, not a struggling, but a struggling graduate student coming here and dealing with the situation as it was.
Yeah, the one thing for me that I would say would be if there's any gap or something that I wish was different or better or whatever, would be more the facilities for exercise or games or whatever. That was a struggle. I have some friends that we like to play tennis and squash and it was, I mean, you gotta book ahead of time. It was really a struggle to get that. But once you get it, the facilities are good. But that's a tough one.
Yeah.
That's a tough one. But I think it's because of the being in the city, real estate, all that stuff, you know. But if there's any way to really build more facilities, that would be very, very helpful.
Yeah. No, I think that's a widespread and legitimate complaint.
Yeah.
When I first came here, it was 1969.
Oh, wow.
Were three squash courts available. They were all over in Teachers College.
Yes.
And no one would tell you about them.
Yes, yes. They had some kind of a basement.
I know, and the pipes would go out.
Yes.
But to be in on that secret was to know one of the crucial secrets of the place.
Yeah. Yes.
Where at other places there were more courts than you needed.
Yes. So that was a challenge.
Yeah.
Getting that.
The engineering. Well, when you first went to your undergraduate degree, that was in engineering as well.
Yes, mechanical engineering.
And
yes.
Where did that start? Did you?
That was at the University of Nigeria.
Right.
At a town called Nsukka in Nigeria.
Okay.
Yeah, and the engineering program is modeled according to the U.S. I think the school was set up working with a school in the U.S. So they emphasize a lot of GS, general studies,
right,
in your first 2 years, you know, where you sort of broaden your mind before you then start specializing. And the engineering is designed for 5 years, the course, as opposed to 4 years here.
And were you selected for it, or was it a competitive situation?
Oh, it's a competitive situation.
Coming out of the school?
Out of high school, you have to take what they call a JAMB.
Okay.
It's a joint admission matriculation board or something like that. And it's very competitive. There's very few chances in engineering. So So you have to compete across. Nigeria doesn't have that many schools. It's not like here where schools are all over the place. So it wasn't easy getting in, but I was obviously top in my class coming out of high school. So I got admitted to a couple of universities in Nigeria, and I decided to go to the University of Nigeria.
Did you have you gone back to Nigeria since you've completed school here?
Yes, I go back and forth. In fact, I almost go an average of once every year or once every 2 years.
And do you have some business connections there as well?
Yes, I do.
Okay.
I do.
So that fits the model of the engineering school as a global entity.
Yes, it does.
You came from another part of the world. You were here. You worked back and forth.
It does.
Between them, yeah.
It does. And the U.S. is, I mean, the U.S. is loved by Nigeria.
Yeah.
I could have gone to the U.K.
Yeah.
But Nigerians love the U.S. I mean, you can't begin to imagine the amount of love people have for the U.S. They want to get here. They want to come here if they could. And the reason is because the U.S. is very open, very open, has obviously the most technology. Technology, and Americans take it for granted because a lot of Americans are not exposed or haven't gone out to elsewhere.
Right.
That's why. But if they do, they will really start appreciating what they have here.
Are there any possibilities of setting up scholarship programs for Nigerian young people to come to, not necessarily to Columbia, but to Columbia as an instance of it?
Oh yeah, that would be, in Nigeria they have a lot of talented kids. Mm-hmm. They are, 150 million people, that definitely have a few people who are very sharp, So they unfortunately a lot of them cannot afford the fees. The fees is just unbelievable.
Yeah.
Where incomes, some people are making $2 a day. So you understand what that means. But that would be great. If there's any way to, and I'll be glad to help Colombia in that process, or be part of the
help. No, it would seem to be. I mean, because the university really is making a commitment to set up global centers, and some of that does involve trying to attract students here from places where Colombia is interested in having more of a connection.
Yes.
And you sort of carved it out on your own. But
yes.
Columbia seems to have provided you with some opportunities that were here.
It did. I know that the dean came and spoke to the alumni in Connecticut, in Greenwich.
Right.
And one of the things he shared, I think he came either last month or 2 months ago.
So this is Dean Goldfarb?
No.
Oh, Dean Penamora.
Not the dean. Is it a president of
the university?
Yeah, the university president.
Poland.
Poland, yeah. And one of the things he emphasized is that one of the strategy being pushed now by Colombia is to sort of be more worldwide.
Yeah.
And being able to have the students actually spend time abroad in the world, basically, to be more rounded.
Yeah.
China was a big one.
Huge continent. When you said 150 million in Nigeria.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, it's big. It's probably about it's growing rapidly.
Mm-hmm.
It's probably about 160 something now.
Okay.
Million.
Well, Ben, if this session were to be, some of it was to be used as a kind of advertisement for the school, or even a serious commentary on the school, and you got to write the script.
Okay.
What would you want to have on the tape?
About Columbia?
Sure.
Columbia is a school in the city that gives you the education, life in the city, the well-renowned professors, the connections in the industry and in the world after you graduate. You can't do any better than that. That would be what I've said.
I'm ready to buy.
Because being in the city is also a big advantage. The city that never sleeps. I remember that there's some nights that, you know, I work, you know, long hours, and I go out on Broadway, there's always a place open you can grab a bite. You don't see that many universities, university cities or towns, you don't see that, only if they're in the city. And so it's pretty unique in that sense.
I would think, without obviously having any direct experience, that for a foreign student coming to America, there are all sorts of very good graduate schools around.
Yeah.
But the location might be a more important consideration than for somebody who was comfortable and had been part of the American scene for some time. Because New York is not, it doesn't belong to anybody. It has all sorts of claims on it from all sorts of parts of the world and people, that it might be a little more comfortable, but I don't, you know, again, I'm not in a position to.
It's a melting pot.
Yeah.
Because you, I mean, when I was in school here in Colombia, I think there was some Iranians on campus, there was some people from Korea that I met, from China, from Africa, obviously, Europe, I mean, then Americans, obviously.
Right.
Who are the, so it's, it gives you that collage of, you know, people with different backgrounds, culture, and it was a growth environment. I really enjoyed it a lot because of that.
And it becomes useful in your career afterward.
Yes. You know how to. In fact, one of my assignments in GE was global assignment. So, and I was traveling all over the world, and I felt comfortable wherever I was because, one way or the other, in New York, I've met. And also people will come to New York, so that's a place also, once you say, oh, you know, I'm from New Jersey or East Coast, whatever, there's, oh, New York, okay. Then you have
the conversation begins.
Yes.
Right.
So Colombia has that advantage, which is very unique. There's no way you can make that up.
Okay. All right, I think, unless you have, I gave you an opening to put in a plug.
No, that's it.
Okay, then maybe we'll get cooler outside.
Okay.
All right, but Ben,
thank
this
you
was
so
very
much.
Nice. I enjoyed the conversation, and I think we'll be able to make some good use of this. But I've learned something, if whatever happens to the tape.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for having me.